Hello, race fans. It's race day. Top five with me, Frank Five. Regular season in the books. The regular season finale at the World Center of Racing under the lights at Daytona occurred last night. And boy, oh boy, in the first time in the history of the regular season finale, hosting the World Center of Racing as the final event to get in the playoffs, it did not disappoint. With an incredible race, incredible action all around, so much drama, so much intensity. At the end of the night, a first-time winner punches it into the playoffs, but in an old, famous number. Let's talk about it. Number one, William Byron is a Cup Series winner. All I can say is, it's about time. William Byron picked up his first career win in the NASCAR Cup Series, winning last night's Coke Zero Sugar 400 at Daytona International Speedway over teammate Chase Elliott, Denny Hamlin, Martin Truex Jr., and Bubba Wallace. What a moment for William Byron. Just at the right time, you pick up your first win at the World Center of Racing, where he's won it before, an Xfinity race in 2017, and he won one of the dual races at Daytona earlier this year leading up to the Daytona 500. William Byron pulled through to get his first official Cup Series victory, and he finally shut up all the haters and all the doubters saying, oh, he won the Xfinity Championship, but he's just a rich, spoiled kid. He only getting it on daddy money. Well, this time he shuts everybody up and brings back the famed number 24 to Victory Circle. The only other name that has won the 24 previous to William Byron is that guy in the corner right over there, Jeff Gordon, the Hall of Famer, the four-time Cup champion, the three-time Daytona 500 winner. He is the only driver up until William Byron last night to win the 24. Well, now William Byron has changed history as he becomes the second driver in the 24 car to win a Cup Series race. And just at the right moment in time, the win locks himself into the playoffs. Obviously, he came in above the playoff cut line at the end of the night, and there was a chance that he possibly wasn't going to be in because with a caution that came out with about 15 laps to go, William Byron decided to pit from third place and put on fresh tires, thinking I can make moves up through the field versus other guys with older tires, because fresh tires, especially on this Daytona surface, can help maneuver the race car and start to pass guys like crazy. And lo and behold, he did. And he had a couple close calls, I'm not going to lie, and I'll talk about some of those close calls a little bit later on. But William Byron just absolutely executed last night perfectly, led 27 laps right up front. Didn't earn any stage points in stage 2 versus stage 1, which probably may have hurt him. But at the end, obviously, winning the race helps you so much. And now that William Byron has that first win, by the way, first win in 98 starts, Chase Elliott and Kyle Larson won in their 99th start in NASCAR Cup Series competition. Byron wins in his 98th start. That's impressive. This is the first of many, and hopefully this is the beginning of the William Byron era and his career. And can he win more races and become a championship contender? Could it be this year or could it be next year? We shall see. But all we know is William Byron finally is a Cup Series winner, and he's got momentum on his side leading into the playoffs. Number two, Jimmy Johnson, the seven-time champ. So close, but no cigar. Unfortunately, Jimmy Johnson, for the second year in a row in his final Cup Series season, missed the playoffs by 6 points. Wasn't from a lack of trying, though. Jimmy Johnson drove his butt off. I mean, before, obviously, last night, the last couple weeks, the Daytona Road Course, both Dover races, a track where he's had so much success. He had great finishes and gained so much points. It looked like he was going to point his way in. And last night, early on in the first two stages, Jimmy Johnson was so aggressive up there, battling for the stage points, needing as much as he possibly can to possibly outpoint William Byron, pending Byron didn't win the race, or Matt DiBenedetto. Jimmy earned 6 stage points in stage 1 and 6 stage points in stage 2. 12 stage points, thinking, you know what? That could help him at the end of the night. Well, we're going to get to, obviously, the disappointing part. With a couple laps to go, with about 2 laps to go, obviously I'll talk about this a little bit later on, but Jimmy Johnson was caught up in a crash with 2 laps to go, and that ultimately ended his chances. But they fixed the car, and he was able to come away with a 17th place finish, what the scoring pylon says at the end. Unfortunately, that is not enough to lock him into the playoffs, but in his post-race interview, the first thing he said was congrats to his teammate William Byron getting his first win, and you know, it's just, he said he's so happy for him, and he's happy for his former crew chief, Chad Knaus. Knaus' first win as a crew chief for somebody not named Jimmy Johnson, obviously. That's also a big part of history in Chad Knaus' legacy, but Jimmy Johnson was, you know, very happy for those guys, and that shows what a true champion and true competitor he is. You know, he wants to win, but he obviously shows so much respect, especially for his own teammate and his former crew chief. That's the kind of guy Jimmy Johnson is. And, I mean, listen, he's not going to make the playoffs. He's not going to get his eighth championship. But you know what? Not making the playoffs this year and last year still doesn't defy who Jimmy Johnson is. A true class act and a true NASCAR champion, and definitely a first ballot Hall of Famer when he's up for eligibility. So, I mean, the best thing Jimmy Johnson could do, obviously, these next 10 weeks is to try to go out and try to give it all he can. And if he were to win a race, that I think that would make up for not making the playoffs, obviously. He had a car that could do it last night. I think he had a car that could have won. He had himself in the right place at the right time for most parts, but that crash with two to go, which set up overtime, he was unfortunately in the wrong place at the wrong time. So I was pulling for Jimmy Johnson last night. I was wanting him to get in, but you know what? He's had a hell of a career, and he's still got 10 more races, like I said, to try to finish out strong, and hopefully he can do it. Hopefully he can win a race, and hopefully there are fans in the stands for the last race of the season where we'll be seeing Jimmy Johnson most likely for the last time. But Jimmy Johnson is a true competitor and a true champion and a true gentleman, and he gave it all he could. That's all I could say about that. Number three, Matt DiBenedetto, DiBurrito, locked himself into the playoffs for the first time in his career, and the first time since 2017, the Wood Brothers are back in the playoffs. Matt DiBenedetto took a big chance on himself a couple years ago when he was driving for Go Fast Racing, and he decided, I'm going to leave the team to try to search for a better opportunity. A better opportunity came with Levine Family Racing. They put DiBenedetto in the car, and he had some really solid runs last year, almost won the night race in Bristol. But he was told he won't be back with the team because they were putting in Christopher Bell. And DiBenedetto took a chance on himself. And after Paul Menard announced his retirement from the Wood Brothers last year, he pointed to the Wood Brothers and get Matt DiBenedetto. He's the guy for the job. And Matt DiBenedetto put himself in this position to give everything he has and show everybody that he's a race-winning driver. He still hasn't won a race yet, obviously, but he has definitely helped the Wood Brothers. Last year, they were like a top 20 car best. They've been a top 10, top 15 car for the most part this year, and they've been running well lately. They've had a couple races in the summer where they struggled and they lost some points, but they were able to get them back by these last couple races. The Dover races, DiBenedetto didn't do well, and there was some concern. But last night, he executed the race solidly, earned 4 points in stage number two, and he came away with a solid 12th place finish, dodging a lot of those wrecks and being there at the right place at the right time, which is enough to point himself in. So big moment for DiBenedetto in his career. Obviously, his wife, she, you know, he admits that she cries a lot, you know, even when they are successful and they have, you know, ups and downs. She's crying with happiness. I guarantee she was crying with happiness last night with Matt DiBenedetto clinching a spot in the playoffs. And now that Matt DiBenedetto's in, the first round features Bristol Night Race. And we all know how good DiBenedetto is there. He could be a wild card to win that race. So Matty D's in the postseason. Let's see what he's got. This is going to be a lot of fun to see what he can show as a true race car driver in good equipment. Number four, the wrecks happened late in the race. The big ones, two big ones, and they were game-changing events. The first big one happened with 9 laps to go in turn 3 and 4. Tyler Reddick, who needed to win to make the playoffs, threw a little bit of an aggressive block on Kyle Busch, knocked Kyle Busch in the wall. Eric Jones, who won't be back with Gibbs next year, he got loose and wrecked Kyle Busch, took out Kurt Busch, Ricky Stenhouse Jr., Ryan Preece, his teammate, Austin Dillon, Michael McDowell. A lot of guys got up in the crash. Ryan Newman as well was also caught up in it. It was his first start return to the oval portion of Daytona since that scary crash on the 500 this year. Everybody was okay. Kyle Busch was a little bit, you know, upset. He felt like he had a car to win. He keeps saying it's still 2020. It's been a tough year for Kyle Busch, folks. I don't know if he's going to have any success in the playoffs. Kurt Busch was a little disappointed. He had a fast car. Ryan Newman and Eric Jones were kind of critical on Tyler Reddick and how he drove, and Newman said, you know, he wins 2 Xfinity championships and he drives in over his head. You know, I get Newman's frustration, you know, because he gets caught up in all these crashes at super speedways. But I mean, yeah, Reddick admitted he in the crash that he threw an aggressive block. But at the same time, he had to. He has to win. He had to win to get in the playoffs. He had to do it. He had to do what he had to do. And Newman, you probably would have done the same thing. You threw an aggressive block coming to the checkered flag in the Daytona 500 this year and paid the price for it with Blaney. And not that I'm saying I wanted that to happen. Never want a guy see get caught up in a scary crash and, you know, wondering about their condition. But, you know, at the same time, Ryan Newman, you know, you point the finger at Tyler Reddick, you probably would have done the same thing. And Eric Jones, you did that a couple times last night. You would have done the same thing, too. So, just saying, not calling anybody out, just saying, He threw an aggressive block. You probably would have done the same thing because you were in a must-win situation. And then the other big one that happened was the one that Jimmy Johnson was caught up with two to go. Joey Logano, Denny Hamlin, and Bubba Wallace were all three wide for the race lead. Denny Hamlin taps Joey Logano into Bubba Wallace. That cuts the tire. Logano sends him around to the pack, collects a couple of guys. William Byron, actually the winner of the race, shot four wide through that calamity and made it through. And all the other guys were caught up. Obviously, Jamie Johnson was in it. Tyler Reddick was in it as well. Kevin Harvick was a part of the crash. A lot of other guys were caught up in it. Matt Kenseth was part of it. Unfortunately, he will not be in the playoffs. So I'm not surprised with the 42 team, since he took over, really hasn't run that well this year, to be honest with you. But there was a lot of crashes. I mean, the early portion of the race, obviously, they were clean. But then, obviously, as we get later in the race, with about 10 to go, the intensity heats up. And we saw that. But, you know, for the most part, everybody drove cleanly last night. And number five. Overall, this regular season finale at Daytona, I was a little bit skeptical about this. When they announced this at the schedule last year that Daytona was going to be the regular season finale, I was like, are you sure you guys want to do this? I was like, I'm not a big fan of this because, I mean, that does allow these other guys that are way down in points to have an opportunity to try to win, to get in. But at the same time, there's a chance that it could cost a lot of guys a lot of good race cars, and they're going to have to rebuild them in a couple weeks. They'd have to go to Talladega and race those cars, or they'd have to build new ones, and they may not be as fast as those cars that they crashed. But I will say, this race kind of changed my mind last night. I mean, normally we run this race on 4th of July weekend. We swapped it around this year with the schedule change, and from what I hear, it's going to be the same next year. I will admit, I did enjoy this regular season finale at Daytona last night. It was exciting. It was clean early on, fairly calm. Guys, you know, we're going back and forth for stage points, especially the guys at the bubble, and Johnson, Byron, and DiBenedetto. We saw other guys up there that were trying to battle for the win, showing how good the race cars were. There was some good racing last night. It was a solid race. I'm not sure if it was almost as good as the Daytona 500 this year, excluding the Newman crash, but it was a really solid race overall. I liked it very much, and I mean, let's do it again next year, I guess. I mean, if that's what it's going to be, let's do it. I mean, it was a lot of fun. I had a blast watching this race. It was so much fun, so much drama, so much intensity. That's what Daytona produces, and it was just a good race overall. Driver recap, Chase Elliott. Wasn't really talked about last night at all, but in the end, second place, our best finish at Daytona ever. Chase Elliott, prior to last night, he had never had a top 10 finish at Daytona in a cup car. I mean, he's won the Xfinity Series before at Daytona, but up until last night, he had never had a top 10 finish at Daytona. The closest was a 14th place finish in the 2017 Daytona 500 race. He almost won, but he ran out of gas with three to go and finished 14th. The last couple times we've been there, we've been in crash after crash after crash after crash after crash. I mean, we had a really good car earlier this year to win the 500. Second place finish last night, not being talked about a lot. I'll take it a lot. And good momentum going into the playoffs. Six of the last seven races of the regular season leading up to the postseason, Chase Elliott has finished inside the top 10. One of them was the win of the Daytona Road Course. And, of course, the one race that we didn't finish in the top 10 was last week in the second Dover race where we were caught up in a crash early on. So I'll definitely take the second place finish from last night's race going into the playoffs. I think we got a good chance to go forward in the postseason. Another thing I want to quickly mention, not only was it the last start at Daytona last night for Jimmy Johnson, it was also the final start at Daytona for Brendan Gaughan, who announced that he will be retiring at the end of this year because he does not want to be in the next-gen car coming up in 2022. I mean, we're not going to be in it next year, and he thought it was the next-gen car was going to be coming in next year, but due to COVID, it wasn't, so maybe he may change his mind, I don't know, but for the moment, it was Brendan Gaughan's final race at Daytona last night, and he got up to his one point at fifth. He was running in the back all night. He got up to fifth of two to go. Ultimately, he finished with an eighth place finish. Good way to go out for Brendan Gaughan. He's got one more super speedway to run, Talladega, and we all know what happened to him last year in that fall race. Upside down, but perfect three-point landing, I guess, but a great run last night for Brendan Gaughan and the Beard Motorsports team. So, the 16 drivers that will be competing for the playoffs, Kevin Harvick, Denny Hamlin, Brad Keselowski, Joey Logano, Chase Elliott, Martin Truex Jr., Ryan Blaney, Alex Bowman, William Byron, Austin Dillon, Cole Custer, Eric Almirola, Clint Bowyer, Kyle Busch, Kurt Busch, and Matt DiBenedetto. Those are the 16 men that will be competing for the playoffs. And the playoffs start this upcoming weekend on Labor Day weekend at Darlington with the Cookout Southern 500, one of the crown jewels of NASCAR place. You know, we'll be playing host to the first playoff race of the 2020 playoffs, and it's going to be a lot of fun. This first round is exciting. Darlington, Richmond, Bristol, all night races. You couldn't ask for a better start to these playoffs. This is going to be so much fun. I cannot wait to see what happens at these short tracks and all the calamity that's going to happen. It's going to be a lot of fun, a lot of drama. Who will advance? Who will be left on the outside? I will probably make a video this upcoming week predicting what I think is going to happen in the playoffs, who will advance, who won't advance, and who will be champion at the end of the season. So I'll do a playoff video to predict about what I think is going to happen. But the playoffs start this upcoming weekend at Darlington. What's going to happen? We shall see. The playoffs are finally here. So subscribe, like. Congrats to William Byron on your first career win. Congrats to all the 16 men that are in the NASCAR playoffs. They start now. And until then, have a good week.